And welcome everyone to episode 135 of the most must-see, most running, award-winning TV show to ever hit the Bedford TV airwaves, or any airwaves for that matter, The Wrestling Connection. I am your host of the most, your connection to the wrestling world, your fedorable felon, Ken Hill. Sadly, Julian and Zach could not be here. Zach is sick at home with flu-like symptoms, but we wish nothing but the speedy recovery for our resident Anaconda Wolf. In the meantime, though, this past Sunday was Clash of Champions, Raw's first solo pay-per-view installment following the historic WWE draft. And safe to say, it was a true Clash of Champions because we had an historic moment here at the Wrestling Connection where, for the first time, the Big Four pay-per-view title holder cashed in. That would be Nick Giglio, successfully cashed in and won the WK King of Pay-Per-View Championship at Clash of Champions. Nick, congratulations on the title. Where is it? Where is that championship?
The what, Ken?
The championship.
I thought I gave it to you.
No, I gave it to you. I awarded it to you.
It's here somewhere. I'll find it.
That's misplacing your championships. All right. So like I said, we had Clash of Champions. Now, history making here at the Wrestling Connection aside, Clash of Champions overall was kind of a middle-of-the-road pay-per-view, just to, for lack of a better term. I mean, you had some great matches, no doubt, but at the same time, you had some outcomes that weren't all that expected, or just kind of fell short of said expectations.
I found it, Ken.
There you go.
Okay. I'll take that.
It's upside down.
Yeah,
you're holding it upside down. Oh, and of course, alongside me,
Hi, Ken.
Mr. Greg Dolan. And of course, Hi. Like I said, our brand new Big Four, our brand, you're holding it upside down. There you go.
So, Kenny, I think I'm going to make you a new promo.
Yep.
What do you want it for?
It's called Ken Lost to an 8-Ball.
Mr. 8-Ball himself, Nick Giglio. And I'm looking forward to that new promo. All right, so like I said, Clash of Champions I thought was kind of a middle-of-the-road pay-per-view.
Yeah, it was great. I won.
I mean, it was great, yeah, that Nick won.
Yeah,
but
top of the road.
Just from like from a unbiased standpoint, from a analytical standpoint,
I didn't even watch it. I'm pretty unbiased. I thought it was awesome.
Well, I thought it was... I'm not saying it wasn't a bad pay-per-view. I'm just saying that it was kind of middle-of-the-road, okay? There were some results that we weren't really expecting here. I mean... There are some that we work, like with Nia Jax steamrolling Alicia Fox, with Kevin Owens retaining the Universal Championship through nefarious means, even if it was a little overplayed. But to get more into it, let's just get into the review itself. Our Clash of Champions pay-per-review. All right, so obviously the first match we had is the kickoff match. That being Nia Jax versus Alicia Fox. Now, this one wasn't anything to write home about. It was just Nia Jax just steamrolling Miss Crazy like a Fox here, Alicia. I mean, Alicia got, I think, a little more offense than people were expecting here, but Nia basically dominated Alicia, squashed her with a swinging Samoan drop for the 1-2-3, and basically just moved on here. So, I mean, the way we're looking at it here, from what I can see, the fact that they're definitely building Nia to be a very credible threat for whoever the women's champion is. Considering where the women's championship is at this point, with it being Charlotte versus Sasha, I could definitely see it being like, I could definitely see Nia Jax being like the first competitor for Sasha when she wins back the women's championship. Because that would definitely make a very monster heel, plucky underdog face type scenario. And I think that would be the best scenario as far as the women's championship goes. So again, Nia Jax picks up the win. Not a big shocker.
Woohoo!
then you get to the true opening match of the pay-per-view, which was the New Day defending against Gallows and Anderson for the Raw Tag Team titles. Now, I mean, everyone had been talking about, okay, this was going to be the last championship. This was going to be where New Day finally lose the tag team titles. They're not going to break the Demolition. They're not going to break Demolition's record of 420 plus days as world tag team champions. But the bottom line is, at some point, you got to like start records over anew. You got to give them a new historical starting point right here. I mean, like with the Intercontinental Championship, like with the WWE, at least in the modern day and age, because no one's ever going to top Bruno Sammartino in a 3,000-plus-day reign as WWE champion. No, that's not going to happen. But the point I'm trying to make is, okay, they're obviously trying to have the New Day, like, overrun the Demolition's record here and start a new tag team title record, which I'm fine with. I mean, the only thing I have against this is New Day is such a hot act nowadays, they don't really need the tag team titles. I mean, you come out here and say, former two-time WWE World Tag Team Champions. You don't really need the championships for that. They don't, for the skits. And if anything, the last month of Doctor skits and Old Day skits and everything else, it's tired. I think it's kind of been a low point for the New Day, and especially for Gallows and Anderson, who were brought in here to be a legit threat in the tag team division, and so far, including the tag team title match they had on last Monday night, that makes three title shots they had against New Day, and they've come up empty every single time. So what was the point of bringing them up aside from being tag team fodder, or did I pretty much just answer my own question right there? Because it seems like all they were just brought to be was just more fodder for the tag team division rather than being a legit threat. Because, yeah, it was fun watching them beat up on New Day. It was fun just seeing them go back to basics, assaulting the New Day at the start, trying to get the jump on Xavier and Big E and isolate Kofi. Classic heel tag tactics, which I can appreciate. I can appreciate going back to basics as far as a tag team match goes. And, of course, the aggression they showed. But, I mean, this would have been a better ideal spot. I mean, you got an up and coming face team in Enzo and Cass. You're gonna have Cesaro and Sheamus waiting in the wings for a tag team title opportunity. And honestly, I think they would be better served facing off against another legit physically tough team in Gallows and Anderson than the New Day. But again, that's just my saying. So New Day gets to win here, retains the titles. I think one of the more surprising outcomes coming out of this pay-per-view, because honestly, this is where I thought it was going to end. But as is, it seems like WWE's intent on making a new tag team title record with New Day. All right, so moving on from there, we come to the Intercontinental Championship. Dolph Ziggler challenging The Miz. The U.S. Championship, Roman Reigns challenging Rusev. Now, there we go. See, Raw, SmackDown, my wires get crossed. There we go. All right. So, anyway, it wasn't so much surprising because a lot of people, I mean, all of us here at the Wrestling Connection had Reigns pegged to win the U.S. title. Rusev has been one of the more consistent performers on Raw the last couple of years. You would think that they would keep him sort of near the top, like in the main event scene, which is where surprisingly the U.S. title is pretty much at this point, because Rusev has really helped bring a lot of that legitimacy back to the U.S. championship, really made it mean something. And the other problem with this is that, okay, Reigns has the U.S. title. He has a secondary title, so that will more or less keep him out of the world championship picture, the universal championship picture. But the problem is the crowd still isn't really going for Roman Reigns because they really don't want him having a championship at all. I mean, because people are hoping that this would constitute a reboot. This would mean a reboot for Reigns, that he goes back to being the silent powerhouse, the silent butt kicker. But the problem is, okay, Vince isn't going to go for that. Roman, as far as Vince McMahon is concerned, is still his golden boy. And anyone who tries to tell him otherwise, Vince is just going to have his fingers in his ears the entire time going, I'm not listening. That's what Vince McMahon is going to be like. Okay, anyone who tries to tell him that Roman needs a reboot, Roman needs a change in attitude, Roman needs a change in direction for his character, Vince isn't going to listen. He's going to keep shoving reins down our throats until we finally just lay back and accept it. That's just going to be the way it goes. So, again, this was one of the ones that wasn't so surprising, but I'm just cautious on, I'm leery on the direction they're going to go with this, whether this will mean a reboot for Reigns as a and his character overall, or if this is just a way of saying, okay, we gave him a secondary title, we're taking him out of the championship picture. What more do you want? So, I mean, again, it's a kind of wait and see here, see what they do with Reigns now that he's United States champion. All right, so moving on from there, we come to the Cruiserweight Championship. TJ Perkins defending against Brian Kendrick. This was the Cruiserweight Championship's re-debut of sorts on pay-per-view, with Perkins' first defense coming, of course, against a former WWE competitor in Brian Kendrick. This one I liked. I mean, it was a little sloppy at the start. It really took some time to get some feet under it, but these two put on a great technical, like, great high-flying technical versus veteran savvy type match, which I like. I mean, Kendrick isn't the high flyer they used to be, so now he's using all sorts of ground-based and nefarious tactics to undermine Perkins' more high-flying technical savvy. So, I mean, obviously, you know, again, we all had this pegged. I mean, well, except for, I think, actually, Nick, this was one of the few ones that you got wrong in this, because you thought Kendrick was, the 8-ball said Kendrick was going to win this, and that ended up not being the case.
No, the 8-ball likes, you know, Anna Kendrick, and I think it, you know, thought it was Anna Kendrick and not this Kendrick.
Well, yeah, he is the mystical, magical Wizard of Odd, so yeah, there's the whole...
So, and I think it was the Anna Kendrick thing.
I mean, obviously the feud's not over, because we saw that on Raw, that Kendrick has a rematch for the Cruiserweight Championship next week. So I like that this feud isn't over. I like the post-match headbutt that Kendrick gave Perkins following their first championship match. I thought there was a great... I mean, I thought that had some great fire to it. So, all in all, I thought it was a good first showing for the Cruiserweight Championship. I still wish they just gotten a much more proper, better introduction overall from someone more attuned to the Cruiserweights like Daniel Bryan rather than Mick Foley. But, again, that's just... I guess that's kind of sour grapes on my part from a number of fans, actually. All right, so moving on from there, we get to Chris Jericho versus Sami Zayn. Now, this is another one that took some time to get itself together, but these two put a great technical contest together. Great action, plenty of fun near falls, very very competitive match. The only surprise really came was that Jericho picked up the win, and pretty much cleanly. Okay, there weren't any real real nefarious means other than just luring Sane into a false sense of security, catching him with a code breaker. And this one kind of mystified me, because really, if anything, you would hope that Zayn, because Zayn really needed the win here more than Jericho. Jericho's more or less just kind of playing the foil, the second banana to Kevin Owens, Universal Champion. So he figured, oh, hey, okay, he's already being bolstered by associating with the champion. He can take a loss or two. I mean, even though he's been on a hot streak, but Jericho again gets the win, and I mean, it continues Jericho's great string of pay-per-view matches. I'm not doubting that, but I mean, we saw Jericho on Raw this past week, but no sign of Sami Zayn. So, I mean, really, I mean, I'm really hoping that we're not going with the whole Neville scenario where, okay, Neville had a few great matches with some quasi-main event talent and then just kind of settled into the background. I really hope that isn't the case for Zayn, because obviously Zayn's going to have like a long march to get back to challenging Owens for the Universal Championship, but I figured a win versus Jericho would have been a great start to that. So the way I'm looking at it, it seems like, okay, they're going to be going for more matter, okay, winning the war against Jericho rather than just winning a one-off match. I mean, that would be great. I mean, to have him win, like, an actual feud with Jericho rather than just a one-off match, especially against someone like Jericho, who's seemingly revitalized himself in 2016, I think that would be the... I think maybe that might be the better long-term option for Zayn right here. But if that's the case, if it's just a one-off match, then it really doesn't do Zayn any favors. Most people say, oh, hey, he gets a rub from being in the ring with Jericho. Okay, that doesn't mean anything. Because, okay, again, Zayn won the last big match with Owens, and WWE has done nothing with that. And if anything, they've halted Zayn's momentum, saying, okay, oh, yeah, it was a huge win, but guess what? Wins and losses don't matter. So that's basically WWE's way of thinking, okay? Oh, yeah, it doesn't matter if he gets a big win or not. He's not going to be challenging for another 6, 7, 8 months. So there. So, I mean, I feel for Zayn here. I mean, both as a character and both feel for the guy, like, in real life here. Because, I mean, he's kind of on the outside looking in, and it's really not fair to him or his character that he's not more immersed in the main event scene rather than just sort of on the outside looking in. So, I mean, just my thoughts on that. But, again, a good overall match. I mean, like I said, missed a few steps. I feel like could have had a little more intensity to it, but it was good for what it was. All right, so moving on from there, we come to the women's match, the triple threat match for the women's championship, Charlotte defending against both Bayley and Sasha. Now, I think we all knew going into this, I mean, the fact that the decision was split 50-50 between Sasha and Charlotte. We all knew one thing going into this, that Bayley was not going to come out the winner in this, okay? It was Bayley's first real championship opportunity, and we knew that, okay, we knew it wasn't going to happen because Bayley had a very long, arduous journey towards the NXT Women's Championship, so it would have made very little, if any, sense for her to win the championship in her first match outright. Bayley is known best as being that same plucky underdog that John Cena was in the early years of his career. So it would make more sense for Bayley to kind of struggle here. Okay, we even saw in her promo on Raw the next night after Clash of Champions saying, okay, she's not going to give up. She's going to keep pursuing it. And eventually she's going to hold that. She's going to hug that championship as tightly as she can when she finally wins it. So basically WWE's they're following NXT's notes on Bayley here. They're basically going by the NXT book as far as Bayley's character goes. So I don't have a problem with that. The only problem really I have here is Charlotte retaining, okay? I thought this was the spot to put the belt back on Charlotte. I mean, sorry, Sasha. I really didn't think that, okay, Charlotte needs a championship. I'm just waiting for them to finally get to the whole Charlotte Dana Brooke feud, which it seems like they've been building to forever. The problem with that is they haven't really made Dana Brooke a very likable character. They have made her more of a toady, more subservient to Charlotte. And, like, okay, we saw just a little glimpse of the fire she could have when she slapped Taste out of Charlotte's mouth a couple weeks ago, but nothing came of that. It was basically like the whole legacy scenario when they were trying to push Ted DiBiase as the one to betray Randy Orton. But that didn't go anywhere because they were judging reactions. It seemed like Ted DiBiase got a hot reaction, but WWE decided not to pull the trigger. And if anything, Orton got more of a rise out of Legacy disbanding than Cody Rhodes or Ted DiBiase. Well, Ted DiBiase Jr., just for clarification. I mean, same thing here. You would think, oh, hey, okay, we would feel some pity for Dana Brooke having to bring her back, bring Charlotte's bags everywhere and being coddled and being criticized and ridiculed and slapped and beat down and all that. But yet, okay, she comes out here basically parroting Charlotte's words, basically being her servant, her woman's servant. And why are we supposed to feel for that? Okay, the bottom line is she keeps going back to Charlotte no matter how many times Charlotte slaps her down or knocks her down, okay? I mean, there's only so much pity we can feel for someone before saying, okay, if they're not going to learn, then there's no point to feeling for them. And the audience, I think, more or less, has pretty much already given up on Dana and is basically just waiting for the feud to come and go so they can move on with their lives. All right. So, I mean, you got, Bayley took the pinfall here. Sasha said as much the next night on Raw, saying, okay, you didn't pin me. You never will be able to beat me in a legitimate one-on-one match. Okay, when I'm 100%. So now we got a championship match, a women's championship match next Monday. This coming Monday, with Sasha challenging Charlotte. Now, Dana Brooke is in Charlotte's corner. So again, we could see Charlotte retaining via Nevers means thanks to Dana Brooke, or we could see Dana end up costing Charlotte the women's championship either accidentally or intentionally, setting up the whole Dana-Charlotte feud for Hell in a Cell. So that being said, I mean, again, this is a great, there's a nice competitive match. I mean, these three have a lot of chemistry dating back to their time in NXT. So, and you definitely saw hints of the Sasha Bayley feud, which I'm hoping that WWE will revisit at some point in the near future. Hopefully, either before the end of 2016 or early 2016, where we may very well see a recreation of their Iron Man match from NXT TakeOver. Which was a match of the year candidate, and I would love to see that again between these two. But all in all, like I said, Charlotte retains here. She's got the championship match going next week, so we'll see what happens there. All right. So moving on from the women's championship match. I believe. Okay, so we've been through the U.S. title, we've been through the tag team titles, cruiserweight championship. Do we have any other matches left besides the Universal Championship?
Did you do Cesaro and Sheamus?
Cesaro and Sheamus. All right, we had the Best of Seven series. This was really the match where you knew they were going to have to pull out all the stops for this one. You're going to have to see something that we never really saw between these two before. Don't get me wrong. I was really looking forward to this. I just didn't like how we got here. I don't think anyone liked how we got here. Sheamus going up 3-0. Cesaro coming back from three losses down to tie at 3-3. It's been played out. I would have been better if this had been kind of like a back and forth, a seesaw match, a seesaw series. Try saying that three times fast. Seesaw series, seesaw series, seesaw series. But again, like I said, we had the final match. I mean, you had Cesaro busting out some interesting maneuvers right here. At one point, you had Cesaro breaking out a 619 a la Rey Mysterio. Not the best looking 619 that you could get from a 260-plus pound Swiss Superman, but still not bad, all things considering. So you had that. So you had them breaking out from their typical powerhouse versus powerhouse style, trying to do things we hadn't seen before, like with the top rope shoulder blocks. Dives to the outside. A scary moment for Cesaro. He took a tope suicida, basically a dive through the ropes to the outside. He got Sheamus, but he ended up spiking his head, landing head first on the ringside mat. Now, for those who don't know, the ringside mat, it's basically just a very thin black mat above concrete. That's it. There's really no other give in that other than just the small cushion you get from the mat. And Cesaro went into that, took a header into that. He spiked himself, more or less. And thankfully, that didn't cause a serious injury. But then the match went to the point where both men were extremely exhausted. They'd already pushed each other far past their physical limits. The ref and the doctors told the ref they could call a match. They're done. But Cesaro seemed like he was still ready to go despite his bad shoulder and his head. Sheamus had to be pushed back by 3-4 guys. So how do they resolve this? Next night on Raw. I mean, the match was called a draw. So how do they resolve this? Mick Foley comes out the next night on Raw. And instead of announcing an eighth match, saying, okay, I don't want to risk you two in another another physically harmful match. I don't want to put you two at risk for severe injury. I see Penn dancing my way. Shoot, 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 shoot. There you go. Shoot, shoot. Okay. So, anyway, Mick Foley comes out. Raw GM Mick Foley comes out and basically says, okay, you two showed the greatest, had you two are the most, you are two of the most physically dominating superstars I've ever seen. It would be a crime to make you two push yourselves through another match where you could end up potentially injuring yourselves. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to split the difference. I'm going to give you each a title opportunity. However, I'm going to give you both the same title opportunity. I'm going to put you two together for the tag team championships. Now, I know what the initial reaction here is. It was my initial reaction that this is basically a cop-out, okay? That they're, I mean, Nick, Greg, I mean, you basically agree with me here. I mean, the whole point of a best of seven series is to see who's the more physically dominating superstar, who can win the best of seven series, and we end up getting a draw and no real resolution.
That sounds dumb.
I can't hear you.
That sounds really dumb.
Yeah, turn it up just a little more.
That is not good.
Well, I mean,
that's just dumb.
I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, I pretty much saw it coming, saying, okay, knowing them, they're going to probably just put these two together, give them a tag team title shot, because they never specified what championship opportunity. They didn't say U.S. title. They didn't say Universal title. They clearly didn't mean Cruiserweight Championship unless these two drop 80 pounds in the next month. But they also didn't specify tag team titles. So, again, no real surprise there. But, yeah, again, it's a cop-out. But in the same token, okay, you want to keep the dynamic between these two fresh because they've already faced off in, 10 matches over the last 2 months. So you got to find some way to keep the dynamic fresh, and probably the best way to do that was to put them in a European powerhouse tag team. So am I a fan of the whole, tag team partners who don't get along but find a way to win? In rare cases, it works. I mean, because you had Team Hell No. You had Daniel Bryan and Kane. And guess what? That worked. It provided for some of the better matches of Kane's career and provided for some of the more entertaining moments of the years they were together. So it can work. I mean, it can work, but and from what we saw last Monday night with Cesaro and Sheamus, it can be a very entertaining tag team. I'm curious to see where this is going to go, though. I'm not sure where it's going to go. I mean, obviously that means they're facing the New Day at some point. So I wouldn't mind seeing them tag team champions. That being said, though, I mean, like I said, First, bum 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 bum. Yeah, just from like my initial point of view, I just was not a big fan of the choice. I like where it's going though. I just didn't like how. I mean, if they had done more in like promoting the possibility of them being like in a tag team, I guess I would have been fine with that. But just the fact that it really kind of came out of left field, the way they went about it was just. I mean, Foley put these two over. He put them over as best he could, saying, "You are two of the best superstars on Raw." That's not hyperbole. So, I mean, credit to Foley for trying to get these two over best he could. It was still a cop out, though. Let's call a spade. It was still a cop out. You should have given one of these two guys at least one more championship opportunity. And I mean, but I could understand where they were. They were tired of the feud. So it's fine. I mean, it's fine for the most part. The outcome is all right. I just didn't like how they got there. All right, so we come to the last match of the night. Kevin Owens versus Seth Rollins, Universal Championship on the line. And I gotta say this was not a good main event. I mean...
What, Ken?
I mean, this was not a good main event. I mean, just from the outset. I mean, it was basically just like, okay, who's Triple H's better son right here? I mean, there were so many references to the game in this one with the crotch chops and the high knees, and a lot of the time they were borrowing from Triple H's moveset, like, but just besides from the pedigree. And I mean, don't get me wrong, they had some big moments in this match with like. This, like the frog splashes, and I mean there were some references that worked with like the DX chop that worked, But the problem is, it was so overplayed. Like, you had the specter of Triple H basically hanging over this match the entire time. That I felt like took away from the match. Then you had, as soon as the ref was down, then you had Jericho coming down, constantly interfering, which, again, took away from the match. I get that Jericho's like aligned with Owens and everything, but this is Owens' first defense. You need to have him looking at least somewhat competent instead of just having someone being completely dependent on, say, like Stephanie or Foley or Jericho to bail them out. I didn't like that. So then you have the ref being knocked out, Jericho assaulting Rollins. Then at the end, you have Stephanie bringing out an extra ref just in time for Owens to hit the pop-up powerbomb on Rollins and get the 1-2-3. And obviously the feud's going to continue, likely culminating at Hell in a Cell. But my big issue, like I said, there was just an overabundance of interference and screwy stuff going on here. If you just had the controversy with the ref and Steph's timing of bringing out the ref being knocked down and Stephanie's convenient timing of bringing out the second ref, that would have been fine. That would have been fine as far as like controversy and like screw job stuff goes. As far as it goes, it was really overblown. I felt like there was too much of it that kind of just overwhelmed the overall match. So as far as Owens' first defense goes, I thought it was kind of shoddy. I mean, Owens kind of ended up looking more like a bit player than like being the title holder, like the major player that he should be at this point. But again, this is the first championship. I mean, Seth Rollins' first few title defenses, his first few months as champion, pretty spotty too. So let's give it, I mean, I think this is kind of another wait and see type scenario. Basically, you're just going to have to wait and find out to see if, like, okay, they do something to help re-bolster Kevin Owens as Universal Champion. First time out on pay-per-view wasn't a good run. But hopefully WWE will learn moving from this point on. All right, so that's Clash of Champions in a nutshell. I mean, Greg, Nick, I mean, seriously though, I mean, just a few thoughts on how you felt like Night of Clash of Champions was like overall.
Overall in general? Greg, why don't you go first?
I thought it was spectacular. I thought they went above and beyond, and they created an event worth remembering and writing novels and short stories about.
Greg, be serious, please.
Okay. I could be more serious. I don't know. I thought it was just another filler. It didn't really seem special from what I heard or saw. I don't know, but I wonder with adding more pay-per-views if they're taking away a little bit of the hype around each one. It kind of starting to blend together.
I'm getting that feeling.
I can't but agree.
I mean, I kind of get that feeling too. Don't get me wrong. I like seeing more pay-per-views. I like seeing more opportunities for certain guys to stand out here. But again, there's that double-edged sword where you see more guys getting a chance to spotlight themselves. At the same time, you run the risk of them like wearing themselves thin with consecutive pay-per-views. I mean, at least with the big four pay-per-views, you don't have to worry about that because with the big four pay-per-view coming out this...
They're big and there are four of them.
Right, well, that, and also being that they're dual-branded pay-per-views.
It's, large pay-per-views.
Yeah, they're large pay-per-views. They're Raw and SmackDown. You don't really have to worry about, like, doing, like, separate build-up. I mean, so that works. But on all the other months, like I said, last month, now you got October coming up. You got No Mercy coming up next week. Then two weeks
after... When's the Survivor Series?
Well, no. October. We're talking October here.
Yeah, just October. Okay.
Yeah, October. We got No Mercy coming up next week, like next Sunday, not this Sunday, two Sundays from now.
Ooh.
And then, like a couple weeks after that, we've got Hell in a Cell, which is actually going to be in Boston, which is great.
No way. Ken, you got to go to that.
Hell in a Cell, which will be a Raw only pay per view. So again, I mean, you got these pay per views 2 weeks back. Back-to-back, 2 weeks over. And
it's every other week is a...
It's every other week. That's,
oh,
that's from. So basically, from Wrestling Connections perspective, from our scheduling perspective, we're basically doing a review today for Clash of Champions. Next week, we're going to be doing a preview for No Mercy for SmackDown. And then we're going to be doing a review the week after that for No Mercy. And then next week, we're going to be doing a preview for Raw's Hell in a Cell.
That's not smart.
No. So now
it's too much. It's like making every pay-per-view like they're trying to make like 100 big four pay-per-views is what they're trying to do at this point.
Well, no, they're not trying to make 100 big four pay-per-views. They're just trying to make 100 pay-per-views.
Waste of time.
It is. I think it's a waste of time. I mean, back in 2002, starting in 2002, when you had Raw and SmackDown pay-per-views, usually just had one of those shows doing a pay-per-view, like say like with Backlash. I mean, Backlash on like April or May was typically a Raw pay-per-view. You had a Raw pay-per-view. And usually SmackDown that week put together some pay-per-view main event quality match. So they didn't even need a pay-per-view. And yet now you've got pay-per-view here, you got pay-per-view there, and then like 2 weeks, like you said, every other week, it cycling again and again and again. I mean, so I just feel like it's a little much here. I feel like it's a little much. Right here, I feel like they'd be better off just having like alternating months for Raw and SmackDown. Have Raw have a pay-per-view 1 month, have SmackDown have a pay-per-view the next month, leading into like one of the big four pay-per-views where you can have Raw and SmackDown together, like Survivor Series, like Royal Rumble, WrestleMania, SummerSlam. I mean, that's where you could have the two pay-per-views together. Other than that, I think you should have like alternating pay-per-views, like alternating months for Raw and SmackDown having pay-per-views. Having both have one in the same month, I feel like just runs things far too closely for a fan's liking, because it makes it that much harder to keep track. Like you're either keeping track of Raw, keep track of SmackDown. Like you said, Greg, it just all runs together after a certain point. So it ends up being like...
It will slowly fuse into one big
thing. Yeah, exactly. And it ends up like making the draft not even matter if you're just going to have like two pay-per-views in the same month. I mean, you might as well just be having the pay-per-views together anyway.
Well, Ken, the reason why they're having pay-per-views?
Yeah, more money.
There you go. Cha-ching.
Well, I mean, it doesn't really matter because it's $9.99 for WWE Network anyway. So,
then that's dumb.
Yeah, it's dumb anyway because, I mean... Yeah, if they were still doing the old pay-per-view purchasing stuff instead of WWE Network, it would definitely be big money. But instead, now you got most people just like going $9.99 and you get two pay-per-views in a month.
Ken, do you pay that $9.99 a month?
Oh yeah, I pay $9.99 a month.
Good.
Yeah, I'm good. All right, I could definitely stream it. I don't approve it. Well, I mean, why go to that much trouble to stream a pay-per-view? Okay, I mean, it's $10 a month. Not the hugest amount of money to pay in the world. So I got no complaints. That being said, like I said, you already know my thoughts on that. So I mean, it's just going to be interesting just like doing like a preview, a review, then a preview, then a review, preview, review, preview, review. We're not going to have a regular show for like the next couple months.
Well, that's not necessarily a bad thing.
True. I mean, don't get me wrong.
I love previews.
I love paper previews and reviews. It's just like, I mean, don't get me wrong. It's good to have a regular show anymore, you know, to stay regular. Regular. Otherwise, everything becomes irregular. Everything just goes completely off the rails more than usual around here. So, we'll see. I mean, I'm sure it'll be fun. I mean, obviously, with Survivor Series coming up, we'll have like a break for a couple of weeks where we do a couple of regular shows leading into Survivor Series, like we used to do. So, yeah. So there's that. All right. So anyway, though, we've come to the end of episode 135 of The Wrestling Connection. He said next week will be our pay-per-preview for SmackDown's No Mercy, which which will be headlined by the triple threat match for the WWE World Championship.
Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun. AJ Styles in his first pay-per-view title defense, defending the WWE World Championship versus John Cena and Dean Ambrose. Of course, we also have the tag team titles. Usos challenging Heath Slater. He finally got his above ground pool, baby. Versus and Rhino. Of course, we'll have Alexa Bliss challenging Becky Lynch for the SmackDown Women's Championship, and much, much more. But in the meantime, folks, stay tuned to the WrestlingConnection.com for all the latest, updates. Of course, our The Wrestling Connection's YouTube channel to catch all of our present and past episodes, including the 100th episode special, which won us our Best General Talk Show Award. So it's an award-winning episode.
Whoop.
Whoop, whoop. And, of course, always stay tuned to our Facebook page. Email us at wrestlingconnection@gmail.com to send all your well wishes and thoughts and comments on the show. And, Nick, do you have a question?
No, I'm waving bye.
Oh, you're waving. All right, bye, everybody. All right, so like I said, just stay tuned to Facebook, to Twitter, to YouTube, to thewrestlingconnection.com. Stay tuned everywhere. And like I said, next Thursday at noon sharp, we will we'll have our No Mercy paper preview. But in the meantime, folks, remember, as always, be connected, get connected, stay connected.
Before you do that, we want you to sing along. Sorry, those are not the lyrics. Turn up nice and loud for us so you can really sing along.
You can't sing it, Ken. You can always dance.
Yeah, Ken, we need some dancing, Ken. There you go. Keep going, Ken. All right, Ken. Nice job. Nice dancing.
I've heard it too many times to ignore it. It's something that I'm supposed to be. Someday we'll find it. The Wrestling Connection. The lovers, the dreamers, and me.
Oh, yeah!